Hey everybody, it's the Boardgame Blogger. Today I'm here to review Autokrator. This is a game designed by Leftiris Iragladis and put out by a new publisher, Diachron Games. Now, this is sort of set in the 7th through 10th centuries, and it's, kind of Europe, Northern Africa, a conquest type game. And one player plays the Saracens, one's the Moors, one's the Franks, and one's the Byzantines. Unfortunately, these powers really aren't differentiated that much in the game. And it's, playing the Saracens is almost the same as playing the Franks. It's just your location and the countries. And it's not too much different than that. About the picture here, I'm not sure if this is sort of representative of the time period. It looks like it's later, like a 12th or 13th century knight. And it's on a lot of things. Well, it's a really neat image. I'm just not sure how accurate it is. I may be wrong. You medievalists out there might be saying, no, this is completely representative of the 8th century. I think it's a little too new for that. For the components, we've got a rule book. It's in color. There's some nice historical notes at the back. That's well done. But the rules themselves, I'm not sure how well they're written. It might be sort of a translation issue, but there's some things in the rules that aren't very clear. When it's discussing victory points, it says the game ends if a capital falls. It doesn't actually say if you take the capital, if you're winning the game, or if you even get any points from it. Normally there's different strengths. Cities, you get different victory points taking over a particular city. This rulebook doesn't address that. There's other sort of nitpicking things or oddly phrased things. So, I think the rulebook's adequate in that you can generally figure out the game. But there's some things left hanging. There's no table of contents. There's no index. Rulebook itself isn't too long. It's just, 7 pages or so. The board here, it's really neat on the back. It's got their kind of picture, that's everything. And then here, a lot of the stuff is this kind of muted orange. And some people I've played with have said it's tough to tell exactly, who is who, just because the colors sort of all blend and run together. I think there's also some information that could have put on the board that's not, especially in the turn. There's these big spaces, if you can see here. This is the, turn 1 through turn 5. And it's a pretty big space on the board. And when you play the game, each turn there's going to be sort of a unique power. Sort of in the first turn, the Muslims have a more powerful navy than the Christian armies. And in the second turn, the Christian armies have a more powerful army with their general than the Muslims. And this could have been, printed right on the board. I think that would have been a lot more helpful to make it streamlined. The rest of the components, the battles occur via, these battle cards. And it's a very neat system. I think that's the neatest aspect of the game, is they've got a very unique and innovative battle system. And the cards, they're decent quality. I never felt the need to sleeve them. Some people might, but I think it's generally a pretty decent card. The backs are unique, so here you can tell the difference between, the Saracens and the Byzantines. They got a logo here in the bottom, and that's nice. The rest of the components, they're, just good wooden pieces. The way the gameplay works is you've got a general, your king, and your admiral. And so every turn people are moving, their three units and attacking and fighting. And there's sort of a set player order, which goes Saracens, Byzantines, Franks, and Moors. And I think because of this, it leads to too much downtime, unfortunately. Because, the Byzantines can really only fight the Moors and the Saracens can only fight the Moors and the Byzantines. Byzantines can really only fight the Saracens and the Franks and so on and so on. And sort of the people in the corners, these people don't really fight these people. But the way the player order works is you're going Saracens first, and then Byzantines. And so that's a lot of downtime for the Franks. You know, maybe the Saracens fight both the Moors and the Byzantines, but the Franks are out of it. And there's this really neat battle mechanic. But that's really all the game has, is this awesome battle mechanic. So I think there's too much downtime based on the player order. They could have, you know, had a different type of mechanism for the player order. And then there's just really no tension or excitement or reason to be focused in this game, because it just comes down to the battle mechanic, and you're just moving, and it's almost like a tit for tat. And okay, this person's having here a battle, and then they have a battle. And there's some things you can do with money and economy, but I think they could have made such a more dynamic system. And you know, one territory is really just the same. It's just where on the board it's located. And you know, they could have just made this game, you know, so much more interesting. And as it is, it's just too simplistic. It's really just an avenue to play their battle mechanic, which is neat and very innovative, and it's fun. But you know, throughout the entire game, you might be doing 20, 22 battles, you know, even more maybe. And it's just, it gets kind of boring and repetitive. And that's the game. It's this tit for tat. Battle, and you're just moving and battling. And there's not really that interesting of strategic choices to make. You know, I found it kind of boring, as long with, you know, everyone I played this game with. It was just a very neat, very fun battle mechanic that wears thin because the other choices aren't interesting, and it's just too simplistic. But I'm sure you want to see how the game itself actually plays. So why don't we take a look at that and the very interesting, and I think the highlight of the game, the battle mechanic. Let's do that now. Okay, so here's the board sort of one turn in. It's still on the first round, so we've got that set up here. Again, I mean, these are pretty big spaces. It really would have been nice to have, you know, the unique factors of each turn printed on the board here, especially because there's no player aids. I mean, for a game, I think to not have player aids, it's just really not necessary in today's games. And you can see that the Saracens have taken over Sicily, and now the way that boat movement occurs is you can move your navy from one port to another port, as long as it's sort of in your zone. So the Saracens and the Byzantines can go to these red ports, whereas the Franks and the Moors, they can go to these yellow ports. And then there's some that share both, as we can see. So that's sort of how movement works there. You can actually move further by spending some money. Again, every player starts with 11 gold, and they can spend money in certain ways. You can use it to sort of move your general or your king unit a little further. You can do your admiral's campaign to actually move them then into a rival sea zone. So the Saracens or the Byzantines could move into a yellow sea harbor and attack that harbor, you know, by paying some money. You can do a truce between peoples, you know, and to break the truce costs some money. And then finally you can do a raid, which raids occur out of either Armenia, or Astorias. And you can have sort of the neutral player raid and attack, you know, the controller of those zones and have them lose victory points. So that can be an effective way to not directly attack. So, you know, the Franks can use that to sort of raid Aleppo, and that's sort of an indirect way that they can attack the Saracens, who normally they don't ever attack. The way the king moves is he can sort of just move one space and attack. And the way the general moves is he can move two spaces or one space and attack. The two moves has to be through a region he already controls. And
you can pay an additional amount, $3, to move an extra space. But as you can see, if you're, if the, you know, let's say the Frank King is there, it's almost impossible to bring him to bear against, you know, the Saracens, or even to bring him over to fight the Byzantines now, because it's going to be a slow process, because the most he can move is two spaces. So, you know, that's one round, that's one round, and then that's one round. So it's just, it's going to be very slow and very difficult to commit someone to a different front once they've been committed. I think the game needed a way to sort of redeploy units, especially because this takes place over, you know, hundreds of years. And so it's just very difficult, I think, to actually sort of just display and change fronts, rather. And once you've committed to a front, you're basically committed for that entire game with that unit, except for the Admiral, who's very versatile. But so let's say now it's the Byzantine player's turn. We see here Bulgaria and Hungary, they can't ever be conquered. And so what we're going to do is we will commit the Byzantine unit. As you can see, it's a sort of a split board here. It's not actually split. It sits pretty flat most of the time. But we're going to have the Byzantine Admiral, and you can choose to move in any order. So you can do first your general, then your king, then your admiral, or vice versa, any order. So that's kind of neat. And one thing we also have that's interesting is here their health ratings. So we can see the king starts with 3 health. You know, when he's gone, he's dead and he's removed from the game. Same with the general and the admiral. But they also have some negative modifiers initially. And the closer they are to death, they get some positive modifiers and they become stronger, which I think is just pretty interesting. It's a neat mechanic. And again, I think their battle system works really well in this game. But there's too much downtime and, you know, the decisions aren't that interesting. I mean, the way you have victory points is whenever you conquer enemy areas, you score victory points, and then there's a final scoring for gold and victory points. So, you know, 1 to 11 areas that you control at the end of the game are -3 victory points, 12 are -2, all the way up to 17 plus, which is a +3. Same with gold, you know, just having 0 gold is -3 points, having 7 or more gold is +2 points, and there's a variety in between for the end of the game. So it's simply control the most areas, a sort of, you know, dudes on the map type of game. But what's really interesting is the battle mechanic. And that's where the game really shines. So let's commit here. Let's look here. These are the battle cards we have for the Byzantine unit. And we sort of secretly set them up at the beginning of the round. You have some defaults. So we can see here, this is always part of the Navy. We've got the Navy symbol here, whereas this infantry always belongs to the general. And you're going to throw in some other cards. So you're always going to have the same few cards. And they have to be different. So I couldn't have put 2 archers in my Navy. So these are going to be hidden, remain from, you know, hidden from my opponent until committed in battle. And so, for instance, I could not have put infantry here and then have 2 infantry. That would have been an illegal move to have 2 infantry in my general's unit. So that's why that was not done. And we've got the mercenaries. Now, there's a lot of information on the card, on a battle card, for instance. So we have how many troops are part of it. So we've got 7,000 troops. They're training. That's the number of swords they have. And then how they fight. You know, their strength in plains, in hills, in the forest, in the city, and in the ambush. Now, I think it would have been really neat if you had resources on the map. You know, if, you know, say, Corinth produced a certain type of resource, you know, iron or something. And then you could purchase or train troops based off that, have, you know, a much larger deck where you're getting different troops that have different training ability, that fight better, and you would have so much more reason to be attacking and getting certain cities. Whereas, you know, why take Damascus over Aleppo? There's really no incentive. But let's commit the battle. So what we have here is we're deciding to send our navy to Sicily here and attack. Now, what will happen is, even though now it's now owned by Sicily, as that's what Sicily's owned by the Saracens, as they conquered it earlier on in the game. Even if the Byzantines attack and defeat the Saracen admiral, they won't actually automatically get to attack Sicily. They'll have to do that on another round in the future. But let's do that battle now, and we'll sort of see. So here's the battle now. The Saracen player has placed down their three cards, and they are aware of the nature of them, and I have my three. Now I examine my cards, and I can say where of, you know, two choices the battle's going to take place. So I can say it's not taking place in the forest, the city, or the ambush, and that's what I'm going to declare. And then of the two places that I've picked where it could occur, the plains and the hills, the Saracen player will pick one. So I'm going to say I examine my units here, and I've got some, you know, pretty diverse areas. So this wasn't a very good selection of building my army here, because while the cavalry is good in plains and hills, you know, it's not so good for the infantry or for the archers. You know, whereas, you know, okay, the ambush is pretty good in both. So why don't we do, you know, the archers and the infantry are good in an ambush, the cavalry aren't. So we're going to announce, okay, the battles are taking place in either the plains or the ambush, and the Saracen player is going to say it's going to take place in the ambush. You know, it's going to be an ambush battle. So we now place down our cards on who they're going to fight. And again, you know, we know it's taking place in ambush. We know that the cavalry unit is the weakest unit. And then we have to put on our modifiers. Now, because the admiral has not been injured at all, there's a -2 modifiers. So I can spread them out on different units, but I'm going to put them both here on the cavalry, knowing that it's weak. The Saracen player will assign their unit. And now we flip and we do the battle. So on our left flank, it's two ambush versus two ambush, which the tie normally would have gone to the attacker, but we've got -2 modifiers. So we have the mercenary wins. Now it's best out of five. So first to three victories wins. We now do the center flank of five ambush versus five ambush. However, they had their -1 modifier there. So my center flank wins, or the center wins, and we now have the right flank. And we have the infantry of four ambush versus the catapults. They're going to win. So now that we've done the left, center, and right flanks, we now do sort of based off the training of the units. So we have three training, because I got two swords and one sword here, nothing on the cavalry, whereas the Saracens are well trained. They have five swords, so they're going to win. So now they've won two to my two, and then the final one is going to be the total number of units. So here we have 5,000 cavalry plus 2,000 archers plus 7,000 infantry, leads to 14,000 total, whereas the Saracens only have 6,500. So that goes a victory to the Byzantines, and the Byzantines are going to win that battle. Now, because it was a direct battle against two rival units, what happens is the rival who loses, that is the Saracens, they're going to immediately lose one gold. Their naval unit will lose one health. He'll now fight better though, but he's closer to dying. And then the one victory point that he'd gotten from earlier on in the game, from taking Sicily, the neutral area, is lost. And now he'll have to retreat, and he'll choose to retreat here. And that's sort of the game in a nutshell. You do your three moves, then your opposing player does three moves, and you rinse and repeat for five turns. You know, there's some different features for each round. It's going to make the game a little bit different. But I think there's just not enough interesting choices. You've got this really exciting battle mechanic, but that kind of wears thin if you're doing it, if that's all you're doing for the game, is just this over and over and over again. You set up at the beginning of your round your armies and what they're composed of, which can lead to some massive brain burning. And, you know, AP, you got to be careful who you're playing the game with, because you can really have bad, you know, slow down in the game when people are making these agonizing decisions on what they're composing their military units of, you know. And, oh, do I put the, you know, my catapults, do I send them to the Navy? Do I send them to the King? Do I send them to the General? And it can just really bog the game down if someone suffers from AP. Again, fantastic battle mechanic. It's not a game I particularly like. I think it drags on too long. I think there's too much downtime when you're not involved in a battle or it's not your turn. Again, you know, for the Saracen turn, the Frank player knows, you know, they don't even have to pay attention. And they may not even have to pay attention for the Byzantine player's turn either. And it's just a very slow game in that sense. I can't recommend it, but I could see how some people who really like the battle mechanic would like this game. And again, the battle mechanic is fantastic. Anyway, till next time, I'm the Board Game Blogger.